Sometimes, when you look around, everything seems still and calm on the surface. And then you detect a little disturbance. And you know for sure that underneath the surface lies some other secret world.
This song was written for a very brave man. A man who preached non-violence in a state which has racism enshrined in its constitution. A man who was imprisoned, tortured, and killed in a jail in South Africa. This is for Stephen Biko.
Meant that when the Amnesty were doing a tour in 86 in America called Conspiracy of Hope, I got a call from Bono saying, you know, we want you to be in this tour for human rights. And then in 88, I took over and did the same job hustling other artists. And then for the first time, I started meeting people who'd been tortured, meeting people who'd seen their family shot dead in front of them, and it's no longer something outside that you read about or watch on television. And they say to you, you know, you can make a difference to our lives. It's very hard to say, you know, I'm busy. although we still do that a lot. So I think that got me engaged, and then things have grown out of that.
The rhythm is around me. The rhythm has control. The rhythm is inside me. The rhythm has my soul.
Around 1980, I started listening to some of the music coming from other cultures. And as an old drummer, I fell in love with some of the grooves that I was hearing. As a singer, there were extraordinary voices that I hadn't heard before. And a wonderful sort of mix of melodies and arrangements. And it just seemed so much richer than a lot of the stuff I was hearing on the radio. I phoned up a group of fellow enthusiasts and started trying to create an event which 2 years later became the first WOMAD festival in Shepton Mallet. Started Real World Studios around 86 in this old converted mill, and it was
part of a dream studio for me, the sort of environment that I'd always wanted. It's a little media center of sorts on a very village scale.
Something of a cultural shock, and I think a big experience for the Ethiopian element who've come across, because they've never been in a residential studio like Real World, and in fact neither have I, although I've been here before. It is a unique setting and a unique studio with a unique sound. It's very laid back and easygoing.
Damn it.
I'm recording now.
So okay, back up.
Here we go.
Also not possible to find piano in Ethiopia, so it's not so much possible. Since I start music, I mean the last 6 years, 5 years actually, I didn't have a piano. So it's nice to get it here.
Studios so that it was around performance to try and get people comfortable. I mean, so for example, in a lot of the spaces, you can actually record in the control room rather than being isolated. For myself, that when you get shut away behind the glass, you know, somebody trips over something in the control room, you don't see that. You only see a whole lot of people laughing, and you think, oh, shit, what did I do? And it's easy to set up paranoia. And then if you've got language problems, culture differences, there's a them and us thing that happens very easily, and people then are not going to relax and deliver what they're capable of.
And I think all musicians are interested in collaboration. And I think when people are concerned about purism, they're denying the ability of a traditional artist to grow as an artist. One of the challenges is the instruments they have are tuned to a different pitch and a different scale than any of the instruments we have. So we're just trying to figure out, should we tune everything to them or should they try and tune to us? And we finally came to the conclusion that we have to tune to them, which means we have to retune every instrument we use on this album.
One of the attractions for me for Real World was the location. I really wanted a place by water. I don't know if it's the fact that any time you look at the surface of water, it's a sort of eternally moving thing. And I think in Native American cultures, there's a saying that when you cross water, you move to a new world. We generally cross the water going to the studio. We aimed the studio and the control room, not looking into the big room at the musicians. We turned it round to look at where we created a pond at the ducks and the swans that live there. But it means if you ever work very late or through the night, normally in a underground studio, you know, you don't know what time of day or night it is. And here you see the light fade and sunrise and the mist coming in on the water and the bird life. And now we have an otter there as well. So there are other entertainments.
C sharp, D, C sharp, C. But don't worry now, Abdullah, we'll do it another time.
Ready? Ready?
Downside for building a studio right here is that the biggest, fastest railway line in the area is literally 20 yards to this side. It comes in at great speed, it's the high-speed train, and then goes very quickly. So it's like in this rural utopian garden, there is a sudden burst of urban contemporary life, just to remind you where you are and who you are.
Peter had built the studio, was beginning to work here in the early 80s, and at that time the WOMAD Festival was beginning to grow. And I was looking after a little record label there called WOMAD Records, where we were trying to find a way of recording the artists who came in to perform at the festival. We had so many wonderful musicians passing through that we thought it was a great opportunity to capture some music. And so we wrote to Peter and asked him if he had ever thought about starting a label.
Well, I never wanted to start a record label. I thought, you know, the relationship between record label and artist is often like a marriage, you know, it's great in the honeymoon. And it doesn't always survive. You know, there are times when you love your record company, there are times when you don't, and when you think you're being ignored and forgotten. And this is a normal part of life, and I thought, I'll just stay on the artist's side. Incredible artists coming into the country, and they couldn't get record deals. So eventually I was persuaded to found Real World Records. And one of the first records we put out was actually with the amazing Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan.
In its 20-year history, Real World has released about 160 titles. A lot of those are the product of fusions or collaborations between musicians from different parts of the world or producers and artists from different backgrounds.
Oh, kardatom ko bandari kardakardakardom.
Recently, the Big Blue Ball project was released, which was the product of many years of such collaboration between artists and producers from different parts of the world.
Was ist das Big Blue Ball? Schwer zu sagen, weil es ein Projekt ist, das ein langes Leben hat. Es fing an Anfang der 90er Jahre, organisiert von Real World. Künstler, Musiker aus allen möglichen Richtungen, aus allen möglichen Ländern sind zusammengekommen und haben während sogenannten Recording Weeks in 1991, 92 und auch 95 gejammt, gespielt.
Recording Week idea came up because every festival there was all these interactions that happened between all the different musicians.
No, a thumb for those two, or for these two, yeah. And then this finger pulls down.
Now, as you can. Here you have these sort of sessions going on and the place becomes like a nightclub. But normally when we do these things, it's one session at a time. And now the whole place is alive. We have these five rooms, all of which have sessions going on under different sort of chairs. And that's just fantastic.
That's the only note you can get out of that flute. The pygmies have invented a fabulous musical technique or instrumental technique, which consists in having a conversation with their own instrument. You know, the technique is very simple, but someone had to find it out, and they did. You ask the flute to speak to you, and the flute says something like, and you reply to the flute by saying,
different musicians come together from many countries and start playing with each other sort of spontaneously, just around the sites and around the touring buses and so on. And we thought it would be great if this time, instead of just letting that flow into the wind, we should actually grab them all here, record them, and create a lot of situations where people could interact together.
Yes.
I could almost do it. You could just play along and just be going, and Dave could just go in and out at the point that he knows.
I can play. That four bars is not for beat, four bars.
That's the bass keyboard, the foundation keyboard.
Yeah, cut that to begin. For one bar.
Right, just for this.
Just dead interesting combinations, you know. Like one, the flamenco player explaining a song via an interpreter to Arona from Senegal, you know. The process of them explaining it to each other, let alone the music, is interesting, you know. It's fascinating.
We were very keen to get something made out of it, but there was so much material generated that it was a nightmare. And every time people would go in there, have a look at it and think, no, tomorrow.
What are we supposed to imagine? There was a mountain of reels of tape somewhere in the real world, in the bosom of Real World Studios.
Yeah, in an old container inside one of the old army Nissen huts that we have. On one side. So Stephen Haig in particular was willing to take on the challenge, and he began to sort it all out for us. But that's why it took 15 years. Rick and I developed a concept, and we asked a couple of visual artists to create an exhibition around the Big Blue Ball. In the center of the piece, the three-dimensional form of the ball was mapped out by these white boards, and it included video messages from all sorts of places around the world. One of the pieces I particularly enjoyed was by Marcus Kreis. It was a scene of kids playing with a global football, but it was beautifully shot from above.
Die Grundidee von Souvenirs from the Earth ist, die großen flachen Bildschirme in futuristische Gemälde zu verwandeln. Wir tun heute so, als ob wir Bilder für morgen machen. Das heißt, wir kommen aus der Zukunft und müssen jetzt ganz schnell auf der ganzen Erde verschiedene Souvenirs abgreifen, filmen, um die dann in eine Konserve zu packen, damit man sich später, wenn die Erde richtig explodiert ist, dann daran erinnern kann.
The project that we've just been working on, the Big Blue Ball, is, I think, an act of globalization. It's an act of trying to bring the world together and to explore it. The moon, it whispers, my voice, screamed just a day ago. Globalization, I think, has had a lot of bad publicity. I think of myself as a global citizen, you know. I still have attachments to my country, but, you know, I live and work with people from all around the world, and my life is so much richer. I've learned so much more from having done that. I think we are at a unique point in our evolution, because for the very first time, anyone on the planet can communicate with anyone else on a planet. In the same way that I can go into Google Earth and actually go down to the tree in my garden, I should be able to, on every statistic like that, drill down and zoom in to the person who's lost their house in a cyclone, who's got HIV, who's in a war zone, and hear their experience, their story, not in the words of the news channel, but in their words, so they can speak for themselves and be seen and heard. So I would call that a fundamental human right and something we can now do with this technology, layer one. We have a thing called Witness, witness.org. Witness.org is a human rights organization we started about 16 years ago to try and encourage the use of technology in human rights campaigning. And the dream is that anyone that has bad stuff happening to them might be able to upload video images or photos or text of what's going on, of their story and their experience. Of observation, which was used to control people in Orwell's Big Brother, is now being reversed on its head and allowing ordinary people to control those in power. Layer two is connectivity and campaigning, where having told these stories, you know there are people who care about them or who might care about them, and the people who are campaigning about them. How do you connect them around the world in such a way that can make a difference?
Hi, my name is Becky. I work on special projects here at Witness. And my colleague Bukeni Waruzi and I headed to Kinshasa to raise awareness about the issue of HIV and AIDS. And we wanted to utilize a powerful figure in the region, Youssou N'Dour, who's an amazing Senegalese musician who cares about this issue deeply.
With the AIDS project for Witness in the Congo, it was wonderful to get the help of Youssou in getting the attention of the issue to a much wider audience. AIDS is particularly pertinent to us because it has robbed us of some of our favorite and much loved artists, and both Hukwe and Charles Zawase would be good examples. I remember really well the first time I heard the Zawasis, and it was the most incredible voice, you know, one of, I think, the best voices we've ever worked with and one of the best voices I've ever heard. It was amazing how long Hukwe continued, because despite losing his physical strength and clearly quite sick, he was still trying to continue. But sadly, as they made a lot more tests, it became quite clear that it was AIDS that he was suffering from, which I think many of us had feared. And he was only to last a few months more.
On the death of Hukwe Zawasi, Charles, his nephew, took up the responsibility for the musical endeavors of the family, the touring and the recording.
Anaimba, anatufundisha kama baba. nalikuwa na nguvu zake tu ajawa iko karibiani kuchoka labda aache hapana.
At this point, Charles was very ill, and he died of AIDS shortly afterwards.
You suddenly get a real sense of the devastation that the disease causes when you lose someone close.
Tunakosa kuuza miziki yetu, tunakosa kunani kuuza miziki yetu CD na nini vitu kama hivi. Kwa sababu ya kuonyeshwa vidole ambacho ni kitu hicho ambacho hata akipo. Sisi tunakosa kazi, watu wanakuja, oh eh. Una mtu anaweza kuwa na kampuni yake kuja kutaka fanya kazi na familia zao, mtu anashindwa kuja kufanya kwa sababu anajua wale wanaumwa.
We thought that one way that we could help to encourage a group to come out and start touring again was to finish the record that Charles had been unable to do on his death. And produce that and make that available and bring the group back to the West for touring.
Very good to see you again. Smash the watch. Smash the camera. Just hear the thumb pianos on the verse, just to see what we've got there. Excuse me, I think that the key is probably too different.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Okay. I think it's better to leave the thumb piano.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Wazuri wanaanza kwa sababu sisi katupenda kwa nini kupiga marimba.
Ufungua marimba na ile iko tofauti. Ingekuwa kizeze vingelingana kwa nini ungechuma.
Dani kashindwa. Mlima wa Tanzania kwenda kulima.
Kukubali dinyi
kai. Chunga ng'ombe.
Keep the Zawasis down because it's in the blood, music is everywhere around them, and they are in their new form still making wonderful music.
Thank you so much, the amazing Zawasi family. Thanks to you.
You You can tell how civilized a person is by where they put the boundary between them and us. And the idea being that the more people you could include in the us bracket, the better things were likely to be. So that the least civilized person would just look after themselves. Maybe next level up is their family. Next level up is, you know, their town or their business, whatever it is, and so on. And it's very easy, I think, for us to think of others as them. And as soon as you start that division, you have enshrined a problem.
In 2005, in the summertime, I was on holiday and Peter called me and said, "Dickie, I've just had a phone call. Do you want to go to Cambodia? I've been invited there. I can't go. Can you go to Cambodia and find this blind musician that I've been told about called Khong Nai?"
Khong Nai is a Chai Pei player from Cambodia. He survived the killing fields of the Khmer Rouge, who with Pol Pot systematically went after intellectuals and artists, and I think decimated or killed 90% of the artists in the country.
That we support Cambodian Living Arts has been started to find surviving master musicians.
The first thing they did was try to set up schools because they thought, you know, it was almost a generation that's gone and we need to jump to the next generation in order to preserve these arts.
When I went to Cambodia, I also became aware of another master, Aung San Suu Kyi. I went to his class and was really blown away by his students there, mainly kids living in the slum area. I saw this class, was blown away by it, and thought maybe one year we'll bring over Khong Nai, but in another year we should bring over this class because they're a real showcase for what young Cambodia is doing now. I decided to take this group and bring them over to England and bring them to WOMAD and connect them with real world. End was we did send them back with a small amount that they could then use with their own will, whatever they wanted to do back home. Female students bought a moto to get her to school because she lives quite far away from the school, and other students did up their homes, their housing, which need a lot of attention because they live in this slum area in Phnom Penh. Unfortunately, this story doesn't have a happy ending. Some of the students lost their homes very recently because the land where the slum is worth a lot of money. It's very central to the city, part area of Phnom Penh. I was working with Peter in the studio and I got word that this had happened just that night, that they'd lost their homes. So Peter said to me, right, Dickie, let's see what information we can get up onto the witness site to let people know globally that this is happening and that this is going wrong.
I know for myself when I get stuck, so I have to leave my family, leave the studio, and isolate myself, and then put myself in motion. My theory is that you have peripheral mental stimulation, visual stimulation, from passing background. So I can sit at a desk and have nothing in my head. I can get on a train and ideas will start coming. We have a global village, but we don't really have the global elders to turn to. And if you have a group whose power in the world is not any longer based on military, political or economic strength, but only on the respect that they've earned from the world through having lived extraordinary lives, and they can be persuaded to work together, then they have a chance of doing something with that at high level. This is a big dream for me.
It is now several years since Richard Branson and Peter Gabriel came to me with their idea of the elders. Since then, I have watched the concept grow, gain structure and strength.
Richard Branson and I felt that if we can't do this with Nelson Mandela, we shouldn't do it, that he was the only person really to found this. The dream was that the elders could be a group of 12, ideally, men and women that have really won extraordinary respect from the world through incredible lives.
The structures we have to deal with these problems are often tied down by political, economic and geographical constraints.
You have a really interesting standoff at the moment in Darfur with Bashir up for trial in The Hague, and now he pulls out all the aid agencies, and so, you know, there's hundreds of thousands of people without food, without medicine, and the international community is powerless, or seemingly powerless, to do anything. The elders may not be able to help, but if this new ecosystem emerges, which really integrates technology and ground movements and has some people at the top who can make phone calls to any leader in the world and will have them put through, then you have at least a way better chance than you have at present. So this is part of the dream. You can blow out a candle, but you can't blow out a fire. What's the flame begin to catch? The wind will blow in higher. Oh,
c'est à vous.